Good morning, Grace. Let's join as we sing about our one foundation.
Thank you. Let's pray. Lord, we rejoice this morning because we are a people who have been called by a king, who have been redeemed by a savior, who are loved unconditionally, and we cannot help but lift our voices and share of our resources and give our very lives for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is that glorious. It is that satisfying. God, you are that glorious and you are that satisfying. I pray today we would be reminded of how good you are in giving us the church, the body of Christ. Remind us why we do what we do. Remind us why this is so valuable in your economy, in your kingdom plan to bring the hope and light of the gospel to a world that needs it, to us who needs it. God, I pray that we use the rest of this service. Use your word to speak to our hearts and renew our minds. Use these songs to teach us great truths and doctrine of the faith. God, we confess we need you. That is why we are here. Because we understand and we confess we cannot do life on our own. But we know we don't have to. The joy is because you have done for us what we could not do for ourselves. And we praise you and honor you. Use these gifts to further that message around the world. May we give it with joy. May we give it with faith. May we give it with generosity to see the spread of the gospel here and abroad. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
That your approval means a life that's free of pain. Yet how many saints I know about have served you without any earthly gain. In their suffering they discovered your sufficiency, and maybe sacrifices where your sweetest blessings wait for me. If it takes a battle really know your grace, or if it's in the desert where I'll meet you face to face, then turn the path I'm traveling to some dark and lonely ways. Cause if it takes a valley, then a valley's what I'll take. Promise that I'm safe within your will. Have I told you how it feels to face the enemy and know you're greater still? Yes, I had to walk through danger, Lord, so you could show the way you covered me with mercy and you never let me go. Some dark and lonely ways. Cause if it takes a valley, then a valley's what I'll take. I'm not saying circumstances never cause me fear. I'm just believing there is a purpose, even when it isn't clear. If it takes a valley to really know your grace, or if it's in the desert where I'll meet you face to face, if it takes a valley to really know your grace, oh, if it's in the desert face to face, to some dark and lonely place. Then a valley's what I'll take.
Amen. That was powerful. I just want to draw our attention to some of the lyrics that we've been singing that we will sing because we're learning about church and why do we do church? Why? And I think the songs we're singing show us why. The first song, The Church is One Foundation, says, "The church is one foundation is Jesus Christ our Lord." And then it says, "From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died." And we do church so that we can grow deeper, our roots deeper into Jesus, so we can know this love that he came and sought us and died for us. And then at the end, we're going to sing how we then shall live because we've experienced this love. We say, "I then shall live as one who's been forgiven. I'll walk with joy to know my debts are paid. I know my name is clear before my Father. I am his child and I am not afraid." The law of love we gladly will obey because of what Christ has done for us. So we're going to sing these songs, and would you please stand with me as we just meditate and sing praises to our Lord. God, you are our foundation, and it's because of your love we can then live in love. May this law of love be evident, and may it transform and shape our lives, that we live through you, Lord, that you live through us. And we praise you for these gospel truths. May you open up our hearts so that they may sink in and start building and growing in these roots, which will start producing fruit, Lord. And we thank you for who you are. And once again, we just praise your holy name. I ask all this in your name. Amen.
Have you ever walked through a garden and seen one of those latticed wooden structures? Usually it'll have a bunch of plants crawling up and down the sides of it. Well, that's called a trellis. And the job of a trellis is to provide support for plants so they can grow and flourish. Without it, the plants would tangle on the ground and not get the nutrients they need to grow or produce fruit. The same holds true for us. As God continues to provide the nutrients we need to grow, we're going to need a support structure to help us along in our spiritual journey. So what does this look like? It looks like worship services, classes, small groups, and other church programs that allow us to grow deeper in our faith with each other. And as a result, we will see the supported growth. We will see discipleship, we will see community, and we will see the gospel spread as we share what we learn here with the world. So we're asking you to let us be your trellis, and to see where God takes us together.
Good morning. Well, as you see, we are kicking off a new series today. I want to welcome every one of you to be here on this Sunday morning. The series is called Why Church? And we will talk about the analogy of the trellis and a vine in just a few minutes as we get into things. But we have been working on this series, the pastors, the staff. We've been planning for it, preparing for it for months. And we really do have some exciting things planned for you and things that we would like to share with you as the series goes on. So stay tuned each week. Some things will be shared with you that we have been working on and are thrilled about how God is using us to reach this community and this world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we do pray that God would use this series to capture our hearts and remind us why we exist as a church. So let's go ahead and start with the title, Why Church? Why be here this morning? Why have a building like this? Why have programs that we do? Why gather together corporately like this on a Sunday morning? Have you ever asked questions? Have you ever wondered, is it really worth it? Is it really worth it for my wife and I to get up our 4-year-old and our 2-year-old, our 5-year-old now, and get him up and get him hurried and make sure he breakfast really quickly and get dressed really quickly, and then we argue a little bit and we get in the car like, get in the, kids, get in your class, we'll go to our Sunday school, hey, how you doing, get in the church, I'm ready to worship God. Come on. Is it worth it? Maybe you're a little bit older, like, I'm past those days, but you know, you wake up and you're like, my back. Why can't I just stay in this morning? You know, you're single? Really? I go to class every other day. I get up early every other day. Why should I get up early on a Sunday morning? It's my day to sleep in. Is it worth it? Anybody ever ask questions like that? You don't have to raise your hand. I know you do. I do. I can tell you a lot of Americans have asked questions just like that. And sadly, in response, have made some significant changes. And it doesn't paint a rosy picture for us. New studies show that less than 20% of Americans attend church regularly. That's staggering. Other studies tried to show that it was about 40%, and they said, you know, about 2/3 of Americans are unchurched. But studies really show when they say that they go to church regularly, they didn't actually mean regularly. And so the reality is it's less than 20%. 80% of the people who we work with, go to school with, live with, are unchurched or de-churched, meaning they grew up going to church and said, no, thank you, I don't need that. Does that matter to us? But it's more serious than that. 3,500 to 4,000 churches will close their doors this year. By the end of today, that means 10 churches will turn in the keys and say, can't do this anymore. Can't survive. Every day, tomorrow another 10, and the next day another 10, and the next day another 10. Does that matter to us? Do we care that that is true? If that's not heartbreaking enough, studies consistently show that the churches that are surviving, the churches that are making it, meeting regularly, 80% of those churches are plateaued in terms of their numbers of people coming in. That doesn't mean everything. It's just one snapshot, but it is an indicator. They have either plateaued or they are declining in numbers, meaning people are leaving the church, especially millennials, my age and younger. 80%. And of the 20, say, well, okay, 20%, there's hope there. 20% are growing. Really? Only less than 1% of those churches are actually growing through significant numbers of conversions. You know what the rest of the 19% are doing? Growing by transfer. One church to another. I don't like that church, I'm going to go to this church. I don't like this church, I'm going to go to that church. You hurt me, I'm going to go there. Can you see how relevant the question is, why church? If it's this hard, if the odds are that stacked against us, is it really worth investing the time, so much energy, so many resources into doing this every week and doing what we do every single day? Is it really worth it? Honestly, we must wrestle through this. And if we look inside the church, if we open the doors and kind of peek inside, we might see what could be contributing to such a church exodus. Because if I were to ask you, what do you look for in a church? What would you say? What does an ideal church look like for you? Maybe for you, the ideal church has beautiful and skillfully played music. Right? Not the kind with drums and guitars, but the kind that you practice during the week and you come in and you hear harmony and melody and it's all symphonic and I can't think of any other musical terms, but it's all working together and it's melodious and beautiful and wonderful and glorious and a big choir and orchestra. Maybe that's what you look for in a church. It doesn't have that. No, thank you. Or maybe on the opposite side, you're like, no, I want music that I listen to on the radio. I want to show up to church and hear the same exact music that I hear on the radio. Maybe you want dynamic preaching, right? It needs to be charismatic, dynamic. Maybe you want preaching that has conviction, but not preaching that's too convicting. You know, you want a preacher to be insightful, not boring. You want him to be smart, but not too smart, not like egghead smart, but, you know, smart enough. He should have great stories to tell. You know, he seems like just a regular guy. He's been through what you've been through. You know, if he doesn't have that, if he's too old, too young, too whatever, too tall, too short, too... Yeah. No thanks. Hey. There's lots of things you might want in a church. Maybe you want a church full of people that look just like you. Right? You want to be able to walk in and see people who are in the same stage of life. We have young children. I want to be able to walk in and see lots of young children, lots of young families. Maybe you're a young adult and you're single and think, man, I want to walk into a church and I don't want to see all just a bunch of married couples. I want to see lots of singles there coming to church here. Maybe you're a little bit older and say, you know what? I want to see other gray hairs. I don't want to be the only gray-haired guy here, the gray-haired lady here. I want to be people who are same stage of life, people I can relate to, connect with. And the reality is, the things that we want in a church might have very little to do with why the church exists and what our mission is. And often what we say we want in a church turns off people who are outside the church. Because they even realize that's definitely not what the church is about. They might not know exactly what the church is for, but they can see what it's not really about.
Mark, aren't you supposed to be preaching good news this morning? I am supposed to, and I will. But we must let the weight of what is happening around us sink in. We cannot be ostriches with our heads in the sand. I took many classes in seminary on Bible exegesis. How do you study the Bible? How do you interpret the Bible? How do you draw out from what it says to understand what it means and apply it to our lives? It's called exegesis. But I also took a class, very strategic, and it was called community and church exegesis. Meaning, we need to be able to understand and interpret what is happening around us in our culture, in our society, to be able to understand how we can then accurately and effectively communicate the gospel of Jesus Christ to the community that we are in right now. Not the community that was in 20 years ago. And if we fail to do that, then we have failed to do really half of what we're called to do, is understand our culture so that we can understand how to take the gospel to our culture. So why? Why church now? Why church right here? We got to go to Scripture and say, God, teach us. Show us. The reason we open up this book is because as soon as we open it up, we are reminded and we confess, God, we need divine revelation. We don't understand. We are not all-knowing, all-wise, all-powerful. But you are, and you've given us divine truth to guide us and lead us and transform us and use us as broken as we are. So let's do that. Matthew 16, 18 is the first passage. Go to that, Matthew 16, 18. We'll jump around a little bit this morning, so be ready. We'll start in Matthew 16, 18. Here's my first point. Why church? Because the church is God's idea. The church is God's idea. In Matthew 16, Jesus has just asked the disciples, who do people say that I am? You know, he wants to know, what are other people saying? And then he looks at them and very poignantly asks them, who do you say that I am? And Peter steps up and he says, Jesus, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus affirms him and says, Peter, son of Jonah, you have been given this revelation by God himself. He has revealed this to you. Well done. And then he says these words, Jesus, and I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, this verse is challenging, and I have to address the idea of what the rock is that Jesus is referring to. I don't want to spend a lot of time, but we have to deal with it. It's in the text, and then we want to move on to what Jesus is really trying to say. So what is the rock? Is it Peter, which many people believe? In fact, that's what the Catholic Church believes, that Peter is the rock. Why? Because his name, Petros, is a stone. It literally means stone or rock. Or, that's the first kind of interpretation. Second, it could be Peter's confession. Right, the rock of what Peter confessed, that you were the Christ, the Son of the living God, that is what the church will be built on. Or is the rock Jesus Christ himself? I think to support this, as the Catholic Church does, of Peter being the first pope, I think that's a stretch. Because let's just say it is Peter. Because that's the most normal way to read this, that Peter, you're the rock. But if he is, Ephesians 2, 19 and 20 say this. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, us, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, notice plural, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. If Peter is the rock, and I'm not saying that's definitely it, you got to figure out where you land, but if he is, then he is just one of many apostles and prophets that founded the church. He is not one that is special. He is not one that is unique. He is one of several, one of many. And in fact, they don't really get the honor. They're just called apostles and prophets. Who really gets the honor is Jesus Christ. He is the chief cornerstone. He is the one upon which all else is built on, depended on, founded on. If Jesus is not there, you have no church, you have no rock, you have no foundation. That's why we sang that song. The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ the Lord. We don't just sing songs because we think, oh, they sound great. They teach us biblical truth. I was taught in seminary, one professor said he thinks that the rock is the profession or confession that Peter made. That is a widely held, especially among Protestants. We don't want to say Peter's the rock, so we think it's his confession of Jesus as Savior and Lord. Maybe. Pastor Brady went to a Bible college and they said Jesus is the rock. There's evidence for all. That's not the point. The main point is wherever you land on that, what Jesus says next is critical to understanding what he will do for his church. He says, I will build my church. Who will do the building of the church? Jesus. Whose church is it anyway? He claims ownership, doesn't he? It's not wrong for us to say, oh, I go to Grace Church, that's my church. I know what you're saying, but let's just not fall in the trap of really thinking like this is our church. This is the church of God. This is the church of Christ. He has ransomed us by his own blood. He calls it my church. The church wasn't the idea of any of the disciples. If it were up to them, after Jesus died, ascended, they would have dispersed and a church never would have existed. But Acts 2, Jesus says, you guys hang out in this room and you stay there until I build my church, until I birth it. Acts 2, Spirit comes down, Pentecost, boom. He forms a church and the church is moving on ever since. The church is God's idea. And guess what? It's still his idea. It is still his idea. His plan, his mission to bring the hope of the gospel to a world that needs it. It's not like the church was plan A, and then he's like, well, that's it, didn't really work. Let me try something else here. Nope. If you ever get discouraged about the state of the church, either here or around the world, whatever, if you ever wonder, why does everything seem to be against us, remind yourself that Jesus says, I will build my church. The building of the church is Jesus' mission. It is his mission. And Jesus will finish his mission. Do you believe that? He will finish his mission. If the Son of God was willing to be ripped open, crucified, in order to rescue his people, his bride, his church, you can be sure he will see this rescue mission through. This isn't a game to him. This isn't a club. This is a bride whom he laid down his life to love forever, and he will do it. What about persecution? Nothing can thwart God's mission for the church. What about infighting among churches? What if people in the church start fighting and churches bicker with each other? Nothing can thwart God's mission for the church. What if the government passes laws and restricts the function and freedom of the church in America? Oh, we're doomed. Look what that government's doing. Nothing can thwart God's mission for the church. Do you hear me? We need to believe this. Let's not walk around off afraid of what's going to happen. I don't care what the government does. We will preach the gospel and you are called to share the gospel. In fact, it might be better if the government does certain things because then we'll actually get up off our seat and do something. We're so comfortable. It's sickening. Myself included. Jesus said, not even the power of hell, not even the devil, the one who's been given the prince of this world, not even one who has more power than you and I could ever imagine on our best day, not even he and all his minions will ever, ever be able to overcome or defeat God's church. Man, that ought to give us great confidence this morning. In spite of those statistics, God knows what he's doing. He has this thing under control. Yeah, it may look like the church is shrinking in America, but it is booming in Africa and in China. And we ought to celebrate that and learn from them. The church is God's idea. Second, the church is a people, not a place. The word church in the New Testament never refers to a place or a building. Never. They never said, then they met at this church. Never. Because the word doesn't mean a building or a place. The word literally means, at the basic form, it means an assembly or a gathering. It's a gathering of people. The compound word for church, ekklesia in the Greek, means called out ones, referring to people. So our fighter verse for this week, 1 Peter 2:9. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness. Notice, called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We are a people called out of something, called into something. This building, I know I'm going to sound heretical, this building is not Grace Baptist Church. It doesn't matter to me what our deed says. I respect that. It's got to say something. But it's the deed doesn't tell me what Grace Baptist Church is. It doesn't even matter that the mailing address says Grace Baptist Church, 7210 Racetrack Road. It doesn't matter to me. They got to label it. Fine. We are Grace Baptist Church. We are the church. The people are the church. That's why when I get up sometimes on Sunday morning, I say, good morning, Grace. Because I'm speaking to a people. We got to be on guard. And the guys will have to talk about this. We want to be on guard and saying, welcome to Grace Baptist Church. Because that's really not accurate. And we might slip up here and there, but maybe we ought to say, welcome to the gathering of Grace Baptist Church. Because when we gather together, whether it's like this or whether it's during the week, that's when Grace Baptist Church is being the church corporately. The church is a group of people who admit readily that we are sinners who deserve God's holy wrath. And yet God loved us with an incredible love that Jesus would take our sin upon himself, endure the wrath of God for our sin, become our substitute so that he would take our sin and that we would get his righteousness. And through faith in Jesus Christ alone, we have received the gift of eternal life. We have hope of life now, hope of life eternally. The church is the people who confess that, believe that, and stand in that truth. People have been redeemed by God, not a building, not a place. That's why Paul says in Ephesians 5:25, Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Notice even the language, personal pronoun, not it, her. He didn't die for a place, he died for a people. Notice I said people. Not just a person. This is corporate. That's important for us to remember because we live in an uber independent society. Super independent. And in fact, that seeps its way into the church, and many Christians view their relationship with God as strictly personal. I've heard people say, you know what, Mark? The church is all messed up. It's full of crazy people, and they are just all kinds of crazy. So guess what? I've decided it's all about me and Jesus. It's just me and Jesus. I got him. He's got me. We're good. I love Jesus, but I can't stay in the church. There's a book by that title. That's like me coming up to Brady and saying, Brady, you're an awesome man. I love you as a brother. You're kind. You're generous. You're insightful. You study God's word so faithfully. You've helped me in my personal life. I've bared my burdens to you and you've supported me in that. And I appreciate our union, our commitment to the gospel. Together we're in partnership for the gospel. I appreciate you so much, brother. But your wife? I have more written, but maybe I'll just stop there. If I were to go on and say all the things I didn't like about Brady's wife, and then I were to say, but Brady, let's go on a double date, man. Let's just go out and hang out and have a good time together. What would he say? He'd say, Mark, you just said you think I'm awesome, but you hate my wife. You want to go out with us? I don't think so. Don't you realize we're kind of like one flesh, that sort of thing? So like, you offend my wife, that actually hurts and offends me. You see, we can't just love Jesus and not love the church. Is the church messed up? You better believe it. I know someone once said, man, I'm looking for the perfect church. I want to find the perfect church where everything is perfect. And the problem is, as soon as you enter into that church becomes imperfect. Sorry to break it to you. I wish. There's no perfect church. Thank God there's no perfect church. Then what would we have to grow? How would we follow? You cannot follow the New Testament unless you are a part of a local expression of the church. You cannot do it. If someone is a Christian and they are not a part of some assembly or gathering, I don't care if it's a house church or a mega church, it doesn't matter to me, but if they're not a part of a gathering where they are preaching the gospel and the ordinances of baptism and communion and church discipline and training and sending out, if they're not doing that, I question whether that person really understands and believes the gospel. I don't mean to sound harsh. How can you love Jesus and not his bride when you are a part of it? Yes, your relationship with God is personal. It's not just personal. Your relationship with God is personal. It's just not just personal. It's corporate. Like I said, when you enter a saving relationship with God, by faith in Jesus, you enter in a relationship with the family of God, the entire family. We read Ephesians 2 already. You are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. That word household is literally the family of God, those who live under the same roof, which means being involved in the life of a local church, which is the family of God in a given location. It means sharing your life with selfish, imperfect, flawed, often fickle people just like you and me. Just like you do with your own family. Funny thing about it is, no one gets to choose their family. Ah! Wish I could! Right? I wish I could choose different siblings, different parents, different uncle. You know, I wish I could choose that stuff. Sorry. Born into that family for life, for better or for worse. We don't ever say that, but that's the reality. You say when you get married, for better or for worse. Well, neither do you get to choose your family spiritually. You don't choose that. God chooses for you. Because he's gone out and he adopts you. And when he brings you home and he's rescued you and he's so excited to have you and he's celebrating, he shows you off to the rest of the family. He says, look, here's your new brother. Here's your new sister. Welcome him to the family. And you look around and you're like, this is my family? He's like, yup. Have fun. Work it out. I'm going to help you. The church is a people, not a place. Thirdly, the church has a mission. The church has a mission. We need to ask ourselves, what is the mission of the church? What is our purpose? That's where the trellis and vine analogy comes into play. We have a couple of trellises up here with vines on them. Last summer, the pastors, we all read a book called The Trellis and the Vine. And it's not something radical. You know, don't go out looking for things wrong with that book. It's a phenomenal book, solid. And it really helps us to sharpen our view of what is our priority, what is our purpose as a church. Excellent book. A few months later, actually, I invited all the deacons. I gave a copy to every deacon and said, hey, let's read this together. I want you guys to read it. I want us to get together, dialogue about it, discuss it, brainstorm, envision together. What does God want for this church body, this family here? It was a great discussion. It was synergistic. And I think the analogy is helpful, and it's also biblical. Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. So there's the analogy. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And then verse 8, I love verse 8. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. So what does it look like to be a part of the church? What is the central mission of the church? There's lots of ways to say it. Here's one way. Try to boil it down. The mission of the church, meaning the mission of us, not just me, not just the pastors, the mission of all of us is to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, to see people trust in the gospel and help them grow in the gospel. Sort of simple if you think about it. Proclaim, share, teach, preach, whatever, the gospel. See people trust in it, help them grow in it. Jesus said, therefore, go and make disciples. That's the operative command. Make disciples. As you're going, he says, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you, for surely I am with you always, at the very end of the age. In other words, bring glory to God by making disciples. That's the mission of the church. We're going to talk about disciple making in a few weeks as a part of this series. But I have to include it here. That is our mission, church. That is why we exist. It's not just my mission as a pastor. It's not just the mission of the programs of this church. It's not just the mission of Sunday morning. It is your mission. If God has set you free from the penalty of sin and death, if he has adopted you into his family, if you are a true follower of Christ, this is what you agreed to make your life about. I hope you know that. Hope you know what you signed up for. And if you're a part of the body of Christ here at Grace specifically, then your mission field, where you're called to do this until God calls you elsewhere, until God sends you out to be a missionary, which he'll probably do for some of us if we're willing and open, until that happens, our mission field is right here, Bowie, Crofton, and the surrounding areas. We got to embrace that. We need to stop thinking that our only priority as a church is to send missionaries. Now, before you heard me incorrectly, we need to stop thinking that our only priority as a church is to send missionaries. Yes, we are called to send missionaries, but we are also called to be missionaries. Let's send and support financially and pray for our missionaries and the mission organization that we do every month. Let's keep doing that and more. Let's have God raise up missionaries and send them out. Let's do it. Who's ready? If you want to be a missionary, this church will support you. Can I say that? Okay. But if he doesn't call you somewhere else, then guess where he has called you? Right here. This is your mission field. You don't get an exemption. You know, if you're doing your taxes, you kind of get exemptions. Yes! I don't have to pay for that. I get money back. Sorry, no exemptions in God's economy. Because you have a great reward waiting. You have something better than a tax return waiting you. You have no idea. We are called to be missionaries. Meaning, this isn't a club, right? It's not a country club. You don't just pay dues so you can come here, wear whatever you want, wear something nice and smile and whatever. Have some friends. It's not why we're here. I'm not here to make you feel good. I hope you walk out encouraged or challenged, but I'm not here to make you feel good. We don't have ministries and programs to make you feel like, oh, now they're giving me what I want. Now they're giving me what I expect. No. We exist to bring glory to God by making disciples, period. Period. In other words, you're a missionary, make disciples. Can't say any clearer than that. Back to our analogy, Trellis and the Vine. Making disciples is the work, in the analogy, making disciples is the work of preparing the soil, planting the seeds, tending the vine, and ensuring it grows. That's vine work, right? Planting, watering, fertilizing, tending the vine, that's vine work. That's focus. If you're doing those things, you're helping you want the vine to grow. You're focused on building a vine. You're focused on the gospel proclamation, on the gospel being accepted by faith, on the gospel growing in people's lives. So what is vine work here? Any of that, in any form, is vine work. If you're an Awana helper and you're working through verses with a child, that is vine work, helping them get God's word into their hearts. If you're teaching an ABC, if you're involved in a small group, if you're having coffee with someone and you're sharing life together, if you have to have a tough conversation and help and hold someone accountable to what they've done wrong or to help them see their error, that's vine work. If you're just encouraging someone who's experienced a loss, that's vine work. If you meet together to pray for missionaries, that's vine work. If you hear the gospel proclaimed on Sunday morning, that's vine work. All those things are vine work. All those things are watering, fertilizing, tending to the vine. Okay? However, the vine can't grow without a trellis, a structure to give it form, a structure to guide it along. Like we saw in the video, you take this away, and the vine will grow in all kinds of places. I know what that's like. My dad had a vine growing up, a grapevine. And when he was actively tending to it and making sure there was a trellis there, man, that thing grew and it had beautiful grapes. And I remember eating some of it. And as soon as that thing broke down, we kind of got bored with that or he forgot about it. Man, that thing was like boosh, everywhere. Our whole backyard was vines. It was nasty and crazy. And there were grapes on the ground and there were never good grapes. And it was just absolute chaos. This trellis is good. It is a valuable thing, a necessary thing to help the vine flourish and grow. Meaning, as you saw in the video, without a trellis, the vine is doomed for failure. It'll try to grow in a lot of directions, but no support. Well, the same goes for the church. A church needs structure. A church needs some kind of form to help vines to grow, to help gospel growth to happen in our lives and in this community. You understand where I'm coming from? You with me now? Okay, so we need a trellis. We need structures. In other words, we need some place to meet. This building is a trellis. Vine work happens here, but the building is just a trellis. It's because every Sunday we don't want to be scratching our heads thinking, now where should we meet? Now where do we go? So we have this building, and we say, okay, here's where we're going to gather together to train, encourage, equip, send out. It's a trellis. We have ministries and programs to help people understand the gospel and grow in the gospel. That's a trellis. They're there. They're in place to help vines grow. We have a financial plan. You have a leadership structure in place. Without those things, the vine is probably going to scatter in all kinds of directions. So it's just some structure to help it. Good, helpful. If we didn't have a financial plan, we'd be in trouble, right? You think, we don't need that. We don't need that kind of trellis. Bring in the money. What do we do with it? I don't know. What do you want to do with it? Buy a car? Here's the problem. If we're not careful and intentional, we can start to focus more on trellis work than on vine work. We can start to focus more on trellis work or trellis maintenance than actual vine growth. You know how it goes. You have a church, it gets formed, maybe it's starting to grow. Okay, we need committees. You need a committee for this, you need a committee for that. Again, not bad things, maybe good things, necessary things to help flourish, help things grow. Now we need a program, now we need a building, so you gotta take care of that and deal with all that stuff. Now you gotta have a budget, then you gotta have all kinds of meetings and business meetings and all that kind of stuff. Again, good things, necessary things. But before you know it, the actual work of growing the vine has been replaced by the work of managing the trellis. And is our primary purpose and mission to manage trellises? No. It's to grow vines. It's to make disciples. When vine work, vine growth becomes secondary to managing the trellis, we have lost sight of the mission. And you think, why in the world would that happen? That would never happen. We all know the vine is the most important thing. Everything else is secondary. Here's why it happens. Because trellis work often looks more exciting than vine work. It's visible. It's tangible. If we put on a big ministry event, which again, could be a very good thing, and we do that, right? So Sunday morning is sort of an event. It's a big event. We all gather. If we put on a ministry event, right, a special event, and we have lots of people come in here, and we plan it out, and we have a speaker or a musical, whatever, It's very tangible. We can walk away saying, look what we were able to achieve. Look what we were able to do. Praise God for whatever happened. That's a lot easier, even though it sounds like it's a lot of work, it's a lot easier than you talking to your neighbor about his life. It's a lot easier than you taking the time out to talk to your coworker about what they're going through or to share with them why you're going through a struggle and how God has helped you through it. It's a lot easier than meeting with someone and helping that person understand what the gospel really means for their particular issue. It's a lot more impressive, too, because you got something tangible for it. No one knows some of the vine work that's happening, and you think, well, that I want it to be visible. I want it to be tangible. And so we can look to an event and say, yes, that's something we've achieved. But the question is, are we focused on vine work or trellis work? Again, trellises aren't bad. Awana, 24/7, U-turn, support and recovery groups, ABCs, worship services, fight clubs, all of that are trellises, but they're good. We just need to be on guard against letting maintenance of the trellis take over from tending the vine. Because the reality is, this vine is flourishing, is it not? It's not only growing, but it's bearing fruit. It's budding and bearing fruit. And here's the reality. Look, it's broken. I don't know if you can see this. This trellis is actually broken, and it's dirty, and it's old. I don't know how old this thing is, but it's kind of messed up. It's not even painted very well. It's not even very flashy or fancy at all, and yet there is a vine flourishing and growing on it. Praise God. This one, it's so fancy. It's brand spanking new. It is clean, not a piece of dirt on it, newly painted. It's shiny. It's wonderful for all to see. And we could say, look at this incredible trellis we have. The problem is there's not a vine growing on it. There's no fruit from it. So should we hang out here and keep trying to maintain this trellis and make sure it looks good? Or should we be looking, where is vine growth happening, and let's resource that. Let's come alongside of that. Let's see where God is working, and let's build a trellis to help that grow and flourish without making us think that the trellis is the work, but the vine is always the work. Church, it is very possible for us to build trellises where no vines are growing. We must be clear about why we have trellises, certain trellises. And we must be willing to have honest conversations about, is vine work actually happening with this trellis? And what trellises are really necessary? That might mean saying no to certain things. That might mean stopping certain things. That might mean starting new things. And that's okay. It should be okay, because if the mission is vine growth, if this is the mission, is it really worth arguing and getting upset over what trellis we have? I know we're quiet because we like trellises. I like trellises. Every one of us does. But if we keep vine growth as our priority, here's my guess. If that is we are just obsessed with vine growth, my guess is we'll talk it out. We'll wrestle with it. Is this one better or this one better? Who knows? Let's go to God. Let's seek God. And at the end of the day, we're going to say, ultimately, I may not get all the trellises I want, but I want a trellis that grows vines. Let's do this for the glory of God. That's my prayer. If you're in a meeting, I invite you. I'm empowering you. We're a congregational church. If we're in a meeting, I don't care, a small group meeting, your class, a business meeting, body life. If you're in a meeting and you sense that the conversation has switched from vine growth priority to trellis maintenance priority, then would you willingly, lovingly say something? If you want to be a congregational church, which we are, that's what the congregation is meant to do, to entrust the church with the work of the ministry. And to be on guard against error and wanderings that would lead us astray from our mission. Here's my final point. We're done. The church displays the gospel. Why church? Because it displays the gospel. When we gather together as the church, we're putting the gospel on display. When we worship together, love one another, bear one another's burdens, help one another press on, sacrifice for one another, forgive one another. When we do those things, we are showing the world and each other, this is what the gospel looks like. The world wants to see the gospel. It needs to hear it and it needs to see it. And when they see the church being the church, they're going to walk away saying, I don't know why those people are doing what they're doing, but that is strange. They love one another and they are so different. Why would that church be so diverse? Why would you have people who are young and old and actually like each other? Or people who make lots of money and very little money and love each other? Why do you have a church of people who like this kind of music and that kind of music and love each other and serve one another? Why would they do that? And we'll get to say, because the gospel calls us to it. And it has changed our hearts. And the gospel has tore down the dividing wall. And though I may never have been friends with Brady before or Scott Perry before or He calls us to one another. He tears down the dividing wall. And we love and serve one another. Together, we can display the gospel in a way that we can't by ourselves. I want to close by inviting up Lauren Benko, who's been attending here really just since last June. Pastor Brady asked last week for anybody to share a testimony about why they love the church, what grace has meant to them. And Lauren beat us to it. A few weeks ago, she actually sent us her story to thank us for a few things. And it was humbling and amazing about what God has done in her life. Here's what I want you to listen to as she shares. Listen to specifically how God has used trellis work to allow vine work to happen in her heart. Lauren, would you please come up and share? Would you please welcome Lauren?
Before Grace Baptist Church, I had not regularly attended church in over 10 years. Growing up, I would frequently visit my aunt and uncle, born-again Christians, or believers, if you will, in Maryland. In California, where I grew up, though, I regularly attended a Lutheran church with my mother until about the time I graduated high school. While I certainly valued the emphasis on community service that my childhood church had placed, and recognize that every church has their own unique set of challenges, my overall experience fell short of inspiring. I felt the church I grew up in scrutinized and was judgmental of others, particularly divorced single-parent women like my mother. When a scandal emerged that resulted in the archdiocese defrocking the pastor and a mass exodus of congregants leaving the church, it was then that I decided to throw out the proverbial baby with the bathwater and stopped attending church altogether. I first heard of Grace through divorce care, which I began attending in February 2013, after my whirlwind marriage fell apart at the seams 2 years ago. While a good friend of mine strongly recommended going to divorce care, I was hesitant about going to church because of my earlier experiences. What piqued my interest in Grace, though, was seeing how the church treated those in the program. I was in awe of the level of encouragement and support Grace offered to members, non-members, and even non-believers alike. And every person I came into contact with was authentically warm, welcoming, and accepting. I was pleasantly surprised that the pastors volunteered their time and offered to meet with the attendees, including myself, to provide guidance on divorce and address any concerns. I know pastors are busy people, and that in terms of priorities, I'm bottom of the totem pole as a visitor passing through one of Grace's outreach programs. Even when the class was over, Grace cared enough about those in the divorce care program to reach out and keep in touch and even host a reunion barbecue. And yet Grace had absolutely no reason to, as I and other divorce care attendees were essentially strangers coming and going. We didn't belong to the church. We weren't dropping large wads of cash into the offering plates on Sundays. Yet the genuine concern was unmistakable and unparalleled to anything I had ever experienced. I first watched a handful of sermons on YouTube to get a feel for the church before I started regularly attending Grace in the summer of 2013. Since I've started attending services at Grace, I find there is no shortage of people making eye contact, smiling warmly, and greeting others. I've never seen a church that is as diverse in terms of age, ethnicity, attire, and background as Grace, which is truly remarkable considering that we live in a society that focuses more on our differences than what we have in common. I feel as though I have learned more about Christ and experienced Christ more through Grace. And it wasn't through people trying to convince me of the veracity of the scripture, but through the example of its leaders and congregants, which epitomize what Christianity is all about. Knowing Christ and serving Christ through loving others. This is done by putting into practice what we study in Scripture and allowing Christ to enter and transform our being, which extends outward to every person with whom we come into contact. One of the things I really admire about Grace is that the congregation isn't permitted to just lapse into the spiritual coma. Pastors Tanious and Walcott's sermons are particularly poignant and pertinent. They are somehow able to candidly bridge the issues that plague society today with biblical principles that span thousands of years, which is a testament that Christianity is relevant now more than ever and is hardly outmoded, as some would suggest. At the same time, Pastors Tanious and Walcott don't mince words and stay true to Scripture, encouraging us to whip out our Bibles and follow along, showing that what is being taught is consistent with the Word. The church also acknowledges very real issues as manifested by its outreach programs and courageously addresses those issues head on, not to condemn, but rather to convict. One of the things that also impresses me about Grace is what an exceptional job it does in terms of getting its congregants connected. The leadership at Grace is nothing short of inspiring. It's people like you and good friends who have led me back to the church and to Christ. My hope is that I can continue to grow in faith so that I can better serve the Lord by serving others the way you have served me.
Like I said, we didn't ask her to say that. She just voluntarily gave that a few weeks ago. And so the question, why church? Because it's still God's idea to use broken people united in Christ to bring a light of the gospel to a world who needs it. Why church? Here's my questions to you. In light of what you've heard, are you part of the vine? Are you even a follower of Christ? If you're not, Christ is inviting you to that today. Are you involved in vine work? Be honest. If you're not, and you're a part of the body of Christ, what are you doing? Are you focused more on vine work than trellis work? Praise God that He is using our church to reach more and more people of that 80% who are unchurched or de-churched, because we are seeking to love people and point them to a Savior. We're not the Savior. Lauren knows that. You know that. But Jesus is. And He is a great one. Let's pray. Father, now more than ever, maybe, we need to be honest about why we exist and to be clear about why we exist and be focused on accomplishing Your mission for Your bride, for Your glory. Help us, Lord. Help us admit we can't do this on our own. Help us admit where we have erred. Help us admit that we are broken and flawed, and that no matter what we do, it'll still be a mix of motivations, and that's okay, but because we can lay ourselves before You and know that, as we learned last couple of weeks in Romans 8, Your love for us is so great and so overpowering and so overwhelming that even if we get it wrong, You are there to love and forgive, and You've given us Your mind to be able to love and forgive one another. Lord, I desperately pray this morning that this church would display the gospel for each other and for the world around us. Would we pray that together this week, Jesus, that we would be the church that puts on display Your gospel? Speak to our hearts now. May we respond as You would call us. In Jesus' name, amen.